Hi everyone. A few people have suggested this, so I'll give it a mention. A lot of work goes into the show, and there have been well over 100 episodes to date. And a lot of good has come out of brainsmatter, from influencing young people into different areas of study, to the formation of a charity to save elephants. Unfortunately, without any funding behind the show, it's become harder and harder to justify continuing it. I don't ever want to make the show subscription only, as my belief is that science is something to be shared amongst everyone. However, if you do want to support the show, there's a few options that I've put up on the website. You can volunteer to subscribe to the show via PayPal for $3, $5 or $10 a month. That's in the range of a price of just one cup of coffee to the price of a lunch per month. Which option's for you? Well, my recommendation is that for students or low-income earners, the $3 a month is your option. For those in employment, $5 would be your option. And for those who are generous, the $10 a month option is for you. Of course, rather than the monthly amount, you can also donate any amount you want at any time or time period you like. You can take my suggestions or choose whichever option I've mentioned that you like. There are links on the brainsmatter website on the right hand side in green in both US and Australian dollars. Of course, this is totally voluntary. It will never ever become compulsory. I've been very hesitant to say what I've said so far, but it's come to the point where the show really does need your support to keep going. Anyway, on to the show. Welcome to Brains Matter, a podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy. Welcome to Brains Matter. On this show, I catch up once again with Dr. Mark Boland from the Australian Synchrotron. Dr. Boland is now the Deputy Director of the Australian Collaboration for Accelerator Science and has appeared on the show before, back in October 2007 in episodes 44 and 45. We talked about some of the work that's been done since I last spoke to him. I'm at the Australian Synchrotron once again, and I'm here speaking to Dr. Mark Boland, and he's been on the show probably about 3 years ago now. So welcome back to the show, Mark.
Thank you very much, Pratap. Good to be back here again.
And since then, you've become the Assistant Director of the Australian Collaboration for Accelerator Science, I hear.
Yeah, that's correct. We had a very exciting launch early in the week by the Federal Minister for Science, Kim Carr, and we've drawn in partners in universities, so the University of Melbourne and the Australian National University, as well as ANSTO, Australian Nuclear Science and Technology Organisation. And we are the largest research accelerator facilities in Australia. We hope to draw in some of the medical community later on with their cyclotrons and other accelerator-based work that's being done in the medical field. At the moment, we're concentrating on new types of accelerators and doing fundamental research in accelerator science.
So what are some of these new types of accelerators?
The two big ones are it's called the Next Linear Collider. There are a few projects, but it's basically a linear collider that uses electrons instead of protons to study, well, hopefully the Higgs boson when it's found in the LHC or if it's found. So what you do with the LHC when you're colliding protons, they're basically bags of quarks, and when you throw a bag of quarks at another bag of quarks, there's a whole range of things that can happen, and there's a lot of noise and not much signal. Once they use the very clever techniques to extract the signal from that noise of the LHC, that will give us an energy which we can then hone in on with a next generation linear collider, which will be colliding electrons and positrons, and that gives a very clean signal because they're fundamental particles. You're not throwing a bag of something at a bag of something else. You're throwing a point-like particle at another point-like particle, so you get a very clean signal. Now, the energy of this new accelerator is going to be extremely high, so of the order of tera electron volts. And at the synchrotron here, we have a ring, not a linear accelerator, but a ring that is designed to produce synchrotron radiation at 3 GeV. Now, that's fantastic if you want to use those X-rays, but if you want to just get higher and higher energy particles to collide together, synchrotron radiation is a real nuisance because that radiation emits power from the beam and you want to put as much power as you can into the beam. So to overcome that, the linear collider is just a straight line. So one of the designs is for about 42-kilometre accelerator.
So where's this going to be built?
At the moment, the key players are the Japanese, the Americans, and the Europeans. So probably in one of those countries. Japan has a lot of earthquakes, might be a problem. California, where they've got the world's longest linear accelerator at the moment, at SLAC, a lot of earthquakes, but hasn't caused them too many problems so far. And then, of course, there's Europe, where there's already the world's largest accelerator and highest energy accelerator with the LHC, which is a 27-kilometre-long circular accelerator. So maybe it's in Europe. Interestingly, one of the professors here at the University of Melbourne in particle physics, Professor Jeff Taylor, he's been telling the community, anyone who listened, that actually Werribee, just outside of Melbourne here, is geologically very stable, lots of land, and maybe that's a place to build the Werribee Whacker.
Sounds like a good idea. So there's a hint for all you people out there who might have a say in it.
Yeah. And then the other major technology and development in accelerator science is also with a linear accelerator on a much smaller scale, and these are so-called X-ray free electron lasers. And the quip is that they're neither lasers nor free, because they're very expensive to build. But what they do is provide very short pulses of X-rays. So in the synchrotron here, and at synchrotrons around the world, what you generally get is a continuous flux of X-rays, and possibly if you have the right equipment you can look on the picosecond scale of X-rays. But what you can do with a free electron laser is you can get a particular X-ray wavelength, really intense beam, and in only a few femtoseconds.
Oh, wow. So that's another order of magnitude.
Another few orders of magnitude, shorter timescale. And the reason why this is interesting is because when you have a chemical reaction taking place, these reactions where electrons interact with the atomic nucleus occur on the scale of femtoseconds. So the desire is to take effectively an X-ray movie of chemical reactions as they happen. And because the X-rays are so intense, you don't need a lot of material. So if you're thinking about measuring something, you can either get a very intense probe to measure that, or you can get a lot of the material. So if you have a very intense probe, you don't need much material. So what they're talking about now, and what they're starting to do, is to have single molecules that get passed through this intense beam of X-rays. And so because you've got such a large number of X-rays hitting a single molecule, you can still get quite a large signal. And so that's one of the things you can do with a free electron laser. They don't have to be in the X-ray wavelength. And in fact, one of our plans is to build a little test free electron laser in the infrared. And if you go into the infrared, so now you've got a longer wavelength, that means that you don't need a high energy electron beam, so you can make it a lot smaller. So we're talking, you know, a few meters to maybe tens of meters rather than, so say, a kilometer.
In terms of piloting the concept, that makes perfect sense, doesn't it?
Yes, and there are many aspects to these machines. So you need to have a source of electrons. So in a device which is only a few meters large, you can generate a source of electrons. And one of the areas that we could contribute to this research is to come up with a very good source of electrons, which is a very tightly bunched, very small source of electrons. So if you imagine a conventional cathode where you might emit electrons, the electrons kind of go in all directions. Okay, and now if you want to gather those electrons, accelerate them and produce a very intense beam of X-rays that are going to be generated from the beam of electrons, the X-rays will take on some of the properties of those electrons because the electrons are emitting the X-rays.
Mm.
So if you have a big cloud of electrons, you're going to get a big cloud of X-rays. And now if you want to focus them down onto a single molecule, it's very difficult.
Mm-hmm.
So what you can do is, right from the very start, where you create the electrons by ionizing material, if you create them in very tight bunches in time and in space, you then will end up with a very bright source of X-rays at the end that are produced by those electrons. So that's something you can do on a very small scale, so you don't need 42 kilometres or a few kilometres. You can do that in a few metres with the know-how and the research.
And now it's time for today's Listener of the Episode. And today's Listener of the Episode is Andrea Newson from Queensland in Australia. Hope you're enjoying today's episode, Andrea. Now back to the interview. So let's get on to some of the work that you've done since we last spoke. It's been, as we mentioned earlier, almost 3 years now. So what are some of the big achievements that you want to highlight to the public?
Right, I'll say up front that I'll be focusing on the aspects of the machine. There are many fantastic things that are done on the beamlines, but I think that's for the beamline scientists to speak about. So I'll talk about the machine itself. So what we've done is, after we achieved first light, which was the first time that we got the machine to produce bright light that goes down the beam lines.
And for the listeners out there, if you hear a bit of a buzz in the background, we're sitting right behind the synchrotron, and right next to us is a light beam.
Yes, in fact, we're sitting in what we call the optical diagnostic beam line, and there is a beam of visible light coming out of the synchrotron, and we've got some special mirrors which bounce out this visible light. In fact, just before we were putting our hand in the visible light, you wouldn't do that with the X-rays, of course, but because you can very easily bounce visible light around corners, we've got a nice little chicane that bounces out the visible light without any of the X-rays coming out. So what we've done with the machine is, the very first thing is that we got it up and running, trained the local talent here how to run the machine, and we now have an operational crew that are very skilled in operating the machine, diagnosing faults, fixing faults, bringing in all the technical staff to fix the faults. And we are so successful at that that we are delivering at the moment 98% of the beam we promise. So we go out to the scientific community and say, here's the number of shifts we have, here's the number of hours, it's about 5,000 hours a year. Give us some proposals, we'll judge those proposals on merit, and we'll allocate you beam time. And what we've shown in the past 3 years is that, since we've been operational for users, is that when we say we'll give that beam, 98% of the time we deliver that beam. So that's one of the highest delivery rates in the world. Mm-hmm. So that's been a big achievement for us.
If only banks could give us that kind of guarantee.
So, but what that has meant for us is that that frees up a lot of our time as physicists, because we have such skilled operators and technicians and engineers who are keeping this machine running, is that frees up our time to think of new machines, to design the next generation machine, to come up with the new accelerator science, like I mentioned before, that, for example, a linear collider or an XFEL or an infrared FEL or a terahertz source or a source of high intensity electrons, and various other particle diagnostic techniques. So we're developing new techniques to detect the beams of particles we have. So those have been the things that we've been able to work on because we have such a nice machine that's operating so well. So it's given us that freedom to go out and do research into new fields in accelerated science. Another thing that's enabled us to do is it's freed up some of our time that we're able to go to the universities and start to co-supervise students. And as soon as you get young students involved who are enthusiastic and well-trained and keen, then it opens up a whole new set of possibilities. So it
brings out that excitement as well when they've got a really good device to work with.
Exactly. So they're excited. It re-motivates me because I can sense their excitement, and it keeps things fresh. Also, teaching means that you have to really be on top of the field yourself. So it's a good way to learn is to teach.
Yeah.
Because you can easily explain something away in your mind when you're thinking about it or reading about it, but then when you have to explain it to someone who will then say, well, is that true or how does that work, then you really have to know your field. So
for that perennial question, why?
Exactly, why? And the things that they're able to do are not necessarily important for the operation of this machine, but possibly they are. That's the beauty of research. You don't know. You're trying to find out the unknown.
Those eureka moments.
Exactly. And so some of the things that we have been working on, and we've teamed up with the high energy physics group at the University of Melbourne, also some students from Monash and RMIT, and what we've been able to do is to make some really nice precision measurements. So recently, one of the successes, we have a student, Harris Panopoulos, who's doing a master's at the University of Melbourne, and his project was to measure the electron beam energy very precisely. So it's interesting to know that the quality of the magnetic measurements for the synchrotron as we built here and the accuracy with which we can measure the magnetic field, which is one of the parameters that goes into determining the energy, is not very accurate. So we only know to within a few percent what those magnetic fields are, so we only know to within a few percent what the energy of the beam is. However, using very sophisticated particle detection techniques and having a good knowledge of the operation of the machine and how the electrons interact on a very fundamental level with the magnetic and electric fields, what we've been able to do with Harris is to do what's called energy measurement through electron spin resonant depolarization.
That's a mouthful.
That's a mouthful. So in a nutshell, the spin-up and spin-up electron collisions are different from spin-up, spin-down type electron collisions, so it matters whether the electrons are polarized or not. Mm. What we can do is we can depolarize, actively depolarize those spins by applying an oscillating field to the beam, and the frequency of those oscillations tells us very precisely what the beam energy is.
Okay, so not knowing the energy levels accurately, you were mentioning before, you know, you had it to within a few percent. Does that affect the measurement outcomes at the other end when you're taking a sample measurement?
It subtly affects those measurements, but the beauty of the beamlines is they can calibrate that out. So what they have monochromators, and the monochromators use atomic crystal lattices to very precisely pick out the wavelength they're interested in.
Okay.
So if the energy of the electron beam is different from what they expected, they will still pick out the right energy X-ray. So in that sense, it doesn't matter. But if the energy is shifted slightly in the electron beam, you get subtle effects in the spectrum of X-rays. So you might get fewer X-rays in the energy range you're interested in. You might get a different behavior of your special magnets, because the electron beam going through your magnet isn't 3 GeV, but it might be 2.98 GeV. So you get very subtle differences, and that's part of this fine-tuning that we're going on with at the moment that will lead to advances in the future. But it's a fundamental measurement. It's very good training for students to learn how to analyze data and learn about fundamental physics. And if we don't understand fundamentally what's going on, we can't do these other more abstract things.
Absolutely.
So that's the beauty of the physics training, and also the time we have now that the machine is operational, is that we can look at some of these fundamental questions.
I believe later this morning you're going to give a presentation on the synchrotron as well.
Yes. So as Deputy Director of ACAS, I'm obviously pushing the ACAS burrow, and I'm going to give a talk to our laboratory. We have in-house science seminars, and I'm going to let everyone here know that doesn't already know what the Australian Collaboration for Accelerator Science is and what it'll mean for them and for the broader community of scientists who use accelerator-based facilities. So accelerators are great enabling technologies, as well as being a research interest in their own right. So they often fall between the gaps, because the physicists looking at fundamental processes, or the chemists, or the biologists, they will just treat the synchrotron as black box, mm-hmm. and it's a tool, and out come the X-rays. And so, in a sense, we are viewed as a service provider. However, if we don't conduct science ourselves and explore the fundamental physics of accelerators in its own right, mm-hmm. then we will never have these facilities. So it's a great enabling science, but it's also a science in its own right. Mm-hmm. So there's this tension between service providing and then also doing the fundamental research for future facilities. Mm-hmm. So ACAS is there to promote these future facilities as well as to optimize the current facilities we have. So
this is exactly what you're talking about with Harris's research as well, how to improve what you're able to deliver for that service delivery.
Exactly, mm-hmm. exactly. And what we're trying to do and what we're naturally able to do as accelerator physicists is to stay ahead of the game, because obviously you have to build the accelerators first before mm-hmm. you can have the X-ray beamlines. So we did that a few years before the X-ray beamlines came online. So we're just ahead of the game. So we're 2 years ahead, hopefully, of what the requirements are for the machine. So we hope to be ready for what scientists want to do in 2 years' time. In 2 years' time, they might come in and say, well, we're going to put in a special magnet, but we need to know precisely what the beam energy is so we can design this properly. It's a really important factor to go into a design of certain devices. Also, they might say, well, we want to just look at a single bunch of X-rays on the picosecond scale. We can already do that type of measurement, and we already do in our special machine studies time, where we close all the X-ray shutters and we just get to play with the electron beam ourselves. And in fact, we use this diagnostic beamline that we're sitting in now, we use the visible light that comes off the beam, and we can measure the visible light in timescales of picoseconds, and then we can compare that, for example, with a laser beam or some other electronic equipment to make sure that we can synchronize. And what we're developing, amongst other things, is what's called time-resolve measurements. So now, in the same way that we mentioned with X-ray free electron lasers, where you want to look at very short timescale things, we can't look on the femtosecond scale, but we can look on the picosecond scale, and we can say, well, let's say we want to look at an excited state of a molecule. How do we do that? We can excite it with a laser, and then the molecule will stay excited for a very short period of time and then decay back down to its ground state. Now, if we can get the timing right, that we excite a sample with the laser and then at just the right time measure that excited state with the X-rays coming off the synchrotron that we've specially conditioned, that we just have, say, one little bunch of electrons that won't contaminate our signal, then we can do these time-resolved or so-called pump-probe measurements. No one is doing that at the moment in Australia, but in the future, one of the scientists might say, hey, wouldn't it be great if we can do this? And we'll say, fantastic, we've tried it before, and we can do it. Let's see if we can make your experiment work.
They're providing the what-ifs.
Exactly. Yeah.
Thanks for joining me today, Dr. Boland. Wonderful to see you again.
Thanks very much for your interest.
And that was Dr. Mark Boland from the Australian Synchrotron and ACAS. You can find out more about ACAS at acas.synchrotron.org.au. That's acas.synchrotron.org.au. Now it's time for some listener feedback. There was huge, and I mean huge, response to the election special episode. Wolf wrote in and mentioned a couple of other Australian Nobel laureates apart from the straight science ones I mentioned on the show. Sharing in the 2007 Peace Prize as part of the IPCC were Neville Nichols and Chris Coughlin. Thanks for that, Wolf. Don't forget Professor David Caroli, who appeared on the show before. He was also part of that one as well. Carl Krzelnicki from Sydney wrote in and said that he loved the open letter. Kay from Adelaide wrote in and said, I need some party to keep science and science jobs alive, and so do thousands of other current and future Australians. We can't have the public image of scientists remain as white-coated, wild-haired loonies. We're the complete opposite. Most of us are very practical, straight-down-the-line people who pursue goals with determination and excellence. Egg Rings from Batemans Bay in Australia wrote in and said, I'm listening to your quote-unquote non-educational unquote podcast right now, and I can say I think you put in a PhD level of effort. thanks again, this is great. Anthony David, who was interviewed on the show, wrote and said, I'm pleased you've given me an opportunity to contribute, also humbled looking at your previous guest list. And based on some other discussions with him, he also said to me, I'm serious about doing something about raising science policy to election issue status. I think I'll take you up on that, Anthony. And on that note, I'll leave you with a quote from Isaac Asimov. Never let your sense of morals get in the way of doing what's right. Bye for now. Thanks for listening to the show. You can check out the BrainsMatter website at www.brainsmatter.com. That's www.brainsmatter.com. And you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right hand side. You can listen to the episodes from your browser by choosing Flash Player from the links and selecting whichever episode you want to hear from within the player. There's also other information on the site, such as links to articles and news, subscription details, both via iTunes and manually, and voting information. Please vote for the podcast on Podcast Alley, and remember to vote every month, since the votes reset at the start of each month. If you want to support the show, have a look at the Support the Show link. You can make a donation via PayPal, or you can buy a book through one of the Amazon links on the support page. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glenn Gertz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now.